Yeah, sorry, I won't be leading a Bible study. We sometimes when Herb Miller is the representative, he does a Bible study. I do a little different thing. Basically, I'm going to take this time. I've got this time and then a little time with you tomorrow. I'll gas off for a while today, and then if we finish a little early, then we'll open it up for Q&A, and then tomorrow will be virtually all Q&A. So be prepared to ask any questions you want. There's nothing out of bounds I can just deny or refuse to answer. And as a highly trained synodical bureaucrat, I can talk endlessly about very little and use that to great effect. So several weeks ago, a woman in the International Center retired after 40 years service. Can you believe that? 40 years service. I was at her retirement party, and she came up to me and she said, "Pastor Harrison, your successor is not going to be as good as you." I said, "Well, thank you very much. That's really not." No, she said, "I am quite certain your successor is not going to be as good as you." Well, I said, "Well, how are you so sure?" She said, "I've been here for 40 years, and every Missouri Synod president is worse than the last." You know, she had a point. She had a point. It's great to be here. Congratulations, David, on re-election. And I pray that you'll continue to be a great blessing to this district, as I know you have been already. So, it's no surprise to you that we face enormous challenges domestically. And I'll outline some of the sobering numbers for you in just a moment. But it's ironic that just as difficult as the moment is domestically, so also is the opportunity enormous internationally. This is the Missouri Synod's international moment. It's the time we have been waiting for, and it's upon us like never before. And we like to talk about our weakness or our lack of capacity or this or that, but folks, let me tell you, the Missouri Synod is far and away the largest and most significant force for preaching the gospel according to confessional Lutheranism, according to Holy Scripture, around the entire world. There is nobody else who even comes close to us. Nobody. And the sexuality decisions of the ELCA, of the Northern Europeans, of the Church of Sweden, of the German churches, etc., on the one hand, are very disturbing. On the other hand, they are driving Christians in the Southern Hemisphere, the Global South, to us right and left. We have been telling you for some time about our partnership with the Makani Jesus. Makani Jesus means the place of Jesus. The latest stats are that church is nearing 8 million people. It's the largest and fastest growing Lutheran church in the world. They need 5 to 10,000 additional clergy over the next 5 to 10 years. They've turned to us. They broke fellowship with the ELCA. They said it was like cutting off our arms. They were a forced union church. The communists killed their president in 1979 and forced them and some Presbyterians into one church. They were in fellowship with the Presbyterian Church USA. They've now written a letter to them saying it's over. In the meantime, they've asked us for assistance, and we've got both seminaries assisting in Ethiopia. We've designed their graduate seminary program. They have 5 regional seminaries. We're helping them with those. We assisted Lutheran Heritage Foundation, and Tilahun Mendeto of our Concordia Selma led a project translating the Book of Concord into Amharic. LHF just last month handed out 3,500 Books of Concord. It was the first time these pastors had ever seen one. They rushed the table like they were picking up gold pieces. It's an amazing moment. Something similar is happening in Madagascar. Here's a church off Southeast Africa that is approaching 4.5 million Lutherans. I've been there on a Sunday morning, and on Sarabe, for instance, 6,000 people at church. They're doing the liturgy, singing A Mighty Fortress, all in Malagasy. You would feel perfectly at home and know what's going on throughout the service. By the way, I was very disappointed going to Madagascar. You know those animals don't sing and dance at all? Al Culver, the director of church relations, was just in Kazakhstan over the last few weeks. He was texting me. We have a small partner church there, and we're coming under fire from the increasingly Muslim fundamentalist environment and government. However, he was there especially to visit the Elcross Bishop of Kazakhstan. Elcross is an acronym for Lutheran churches in the former Soviet Union and Russia, and there are several of them. This bishop happens to be the current head of all of them. He's asking us for church fellowship. It's an enormous moment. In Central and South America, we have learned from Ted Cray, our fabulous missionary and executive regional director for Central and South America. We've learned that where we have not started and maintained seminaries from the beginning in our partner churches, the church has remained very small. There are only 130 confessionally Lutheran pastors in fellowship with the Missouri Synod from Mexico to Argentina, Spanish-speaking. Brazil's its own case. It's Portuguese. It's our largest partner church, 2,000 congregations, 800 pastors. Argentina, by far the next largest capacity. We started seminaries there, and we've maintained them to this day. But I'm happy to tell you, through the Global Seminary Initiative, we have now 80 students studying theology in Spanish, mostly at the Argentine Seminary. 80 right now. And the need will continue to grow. The request for deaconess programs is happening all over. It's the moment, folks. It's really the moment. Africa is burgeoning. We talk sometimes, we say, well, we need to close a seminary. Folks, yes, our current use of the seminaries is down with students. There is a need. All the students were placed this last time. In fact, all students of our seminaries have been placed for the last 5 years. And we were down 20 students this year, right, to fill all the requests, David? Yep. We were down about 30. We needed 30 more vicars to fulfill all the requests. It's time to go to the seminary. The need is there, and we're approaching. We have not had a shortage of pastors. We're approaching what will be, and that is many pastors, large retiring classes over the next 10 to 15 years. But my main point is here, we need the seminary capacity because we've got these guys running all over the world, strengthening our partners. And they're in difficult situations in Africa. As many of you know, they face Pentecostalism and name it and claim it theology, prosperity theology. It's everywhere. And secondarily, they face Islam and have a difficult row to hoe, and still they're growing. On the domestic side, it's really challenging business. I have been studying the performance of each district over the last 40 and particularly the last 10 years. The picture is not pretty. Overall, the Missouri Synod in 40 years has declined 18%. Now, we're performing better than most other old line, mainline churches. The UCC is down 50%. Presbyterian Church USA down almost 40%. The ELCA down nearly 30%. Since its founding in 1987, the ELCA has closed 1,500 congregations. We have maintained pretty much the same number, 6,200 for 40 years. Our districts are challenged in the places you would expect them to be challenged. In just 10 years, the New England district is down 25% of the baptized. Northwest district down 25% of the baptized. New Jersey district down 33% of the baptized. California, Nevada, Hawaii down 27% of the baptized. The next level of decline, the Eastern District, the Ohio District, the Northern Illinois District, all down 18 or 19%. The next level of decline, 12 to 14%. Michigan down 12. Southern Minnesota down 12 plus. South Wisconsin down 12, 13%. North Wisconsin down the same. Pacific Southwest down 12%. And then finally, the districts that have performed the best are the most rural rural districts. Nebraska down 6%. Kansas down 6 or 7%. Southern Illinois down 6%. Missouri 6 or 7%. Indiana down 7%. Do you know what the best performing district of the last 10 years has been? Any guesses? What? North Dakota. Unfortunately, no. It is that radical bastion of church growthism known as South Dakota. And some other things arise. Well, we know from this map that the Synod does most poorly in urban areas. This is no surprise to you Michiganders at all. Secondly, the Synod is most challenged where the nation is most secular. Again, no surprise. But there is one surprise I found. That is Iowa East and Iowa West. Iowa East has a flat black SWAT truck with RPGs mounted on top, and whenever they find a praise band within 50 yards of a chancel, they attack and destroy. And they practice close communion very carefully, and I define that now after watching Victor Borge this way. Close-foot communion. Close-communion, which is the official position. Guess what? Iowa West, much more moderate on both counts. Both districts down exactly 12% in 10 years. Exactly. That tells me, by and large, that the things we use to beat each other over the head and blame each other for are largely not issues at all. Now, in the midst of these challenges, some things become clear. Number one, demographically, we are in the midst of a long-term shift. First, our families, as European descent Americans, by and large, and we are the most white church in the United States, aside from the ELCA, so there's something to be proud about. Aside from the ELCA, we have experienced the decline of the family like every other European descent culture and across America. We are a middle-class, upper-middle-class church. Virtually all of our children, a large percent of our children, are going to university. And that delays marriage. The culture all over is delaying marriage, if they're getting married at all. And a huge factor, in fact, one of the number one factors determining when when a couple starts a family and how many children they have is educational debt. And we are at the time of our country where we have almost universal and large educational debt. So I promised my kids I'm going to subsidize each child. I haven't quite figured out the number on that yet, but I'll take your advice maybe. A second issue is, in populations that are growing, largely immigrant populations, we are underrepresented. Now, we have made a whole lot of progress. The Missouri Synod probably has worship in about 100 different languages every Sunday. But when I go across the country and look at these assemblies, aside from a place like the Atlantic District, we are virtually lily white. And you care about what you count. We have not, as a synod, been counting, that is nationally, we have not been counting the number of non-Anglo pastors, non-Anglo ministries, and therefore not setting goals and attempting to meet them and tracking them. That's something I've asked our Office of National Ministry to begin doing, and they're doing it. So we face those challenges, and they are before us. It's also the case that last year, half of our congregations did not have one adult conversion. Not a single adult conversion. Half. God help us. It is time for repentance. But amidst this, the Lord also blesses richly. Indeed. There's some good news in the Synod. There's a lot of good things happening. I'm happy to say that the church is quite calm virtually everywhere. That's really nice to see. Much calmer than it's been in quite a while. I'm happy to say that there's been a round of new district presidents elected, and they are extremely fine men. That is a blessing. We have many assets. I'm happy to tell you that 5 years ago when I started, the Synod was $16 million in debt to itself. That is, in debt to designated funds. That meant, as funds came in for the youth gathering, several million dollars the year before, and started working their way through the synodical python, you know, we'd borrow them, we'd use them for operations instead of borrowing money from LCF and paying interest. It just made sense, not illegal. But then all of a sudden, when those dollars went to the youth gathering, oh, we'd need to fill the hole. And thank God Almighty some mega disaster had come along. And then we'd have millions of dollars in the coffers, and that would be spent down over a couple of years. And then the next youth gathering, and then some bequest would come in, and then who knows what else. This has been the practice for decades. I'm happy to tell you that the Synod treasurer told me just 2 months ago we had paid back every single dollar. At the convention 2 years ago, at that time we were down to about 70 career missionaries. We made it the goal at the convention to double the number of career missionaries over the next 3 years. Within 2 years now, we have now accomplished that goal already. Every regional, every area in the world has a strategic plan. And we have loads of opportunities. If you want to become a missionary, lay or clergy, let us know. The highest number of missionaries, according to convention reports, national convention reports, was 250, approximately 50 years ago. Just when I was a small child, born in 62. Folks, right now we have 15% of our congregations supporting a missionary directly. If you want to talk about how this all works, talk to your Vice President Neuendorp. He's got a couple of kids on the field, and they are just outstanding young people. I have so enjoyed watching them grow, both son and daughter-in-law, over the last number of years. They're doing an excellent job in the Dominican. And the mission there is booming. Not without difficulty, but it's booming. Only 15% of our congregations directly support an LCMS career missionary. Only 2% of our 600,000 households directly support a missionary. I know you support all kinds of things which are great, and you need to continue to support them. Most ministries, fantastic. Praise the Lord. They work with us, with our partner churches, with our mission fields, and just do fabulous work. And there are many other such entities. The recent CCM decision, there was a lot of folder all about, doesn't say anything about mission societies. It says very little about congregations. We want you involved internationally. We want you doing short-term trips. We want you engaging your people and letting them know what opportunities are around. We want them involved in mercy around the world. But if we concentrate just a little bit, we will blow the lid off the all-time record of 250 career missionaries. We can do this, and we can do it soon. Let's do it, shall we? Why don't we? We also have the Lutheran Church Extension Fund, $1.8 billion, with only 4% of the Synod investing. How many of you heard about the new Lutheran Federal Credit Union? Lutheran Federal Credit Union. Not too many. Well, I have something to tell you. Are there any bankers in here? That's good. Those darn bankers, I tell you. Nah, just kidding. God loves bankers too. But LCF has spun off, and with the work and approval of the LCMS Board of Directors, a Lutheran Federal Credit Union. 2 years ago, they applied to the federal regulators for the forming of this entity, along with 70 other applicants across the country. Guess what? There was only one approval granted to our entity. Rich Robertson of LCF tells me that the experts are predicting that this credit union can and likely will become one of the top 50 credit unions in the United States, offering services to congregations, state-of-the-art online banking, so that your online banking can all be done through the website, savings accounts, checking accounts, credit cards for congregations and individuals, housing loans, student loans, you name it. And you know what's nice about this? All those fees that would go to Wall Street are going to come to the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod and its ministries. So imagine next convention. This convention brought to you by the Lutheran Federal Credit Union. And your subsidy for the convention significantly reduced. Or imagine this ministry in the Michigan District brought to you by the Lutheran Federal Credit Union. And it's going to be important for us to take advantage of this just at this time. I think we are one slippery liberal Catholic judge named Kennedy away from decisions in the future that could well end our ability to take part, our university's abilities to take part in federal student loan programs unless we capitulate on the definition of marriage at our universities. We face some sobering times. This is an important institution, and it's great news for us. The LCMS Foundation is healthy. The Concordia Plans is healthy. Yes, because of the circumstances, rates have gone up, and believe me, I head up an operation which is about $80 million. So when your congregation, your small congregation is hit with a large increase in Concordia plan, health plan things, I can feel your pain, literally, because we have all the same budgeting issues on the scale of an $80 million organization. But nevertheless, many other denominations have had great difficulty with their entities. Some have struggled mightily, making huge cuts in retirement benefits. Ours has not had to do that because of sound fiscal management. It's important for the challenges that we face now to move beyond certain controversial issues. I mentioned closed communion. Look, folks, if you have a bulletin that says, if you believe the catechism and the real presence, y'all come, that is not the synodical position. Never has been. And this last convention asked me 77% to bring this issue up with our district presidents and with you. However, let me say this. We all believe in pastoral discretion, all of us. Some of us draw that discretion narrower, some wider. I simply say this. If you simply put in your bulletin, please speak to the pastor or an usher or elder if you have a large congregation before communing, the issue as a controversial one among us virtually disappears. Doesn't it? Is this so difficult? It's time for us to get our act together. I think probably the culture around us battering upon us will do more to unite us than anything we can try to do internally, don't you think? But we can do this, folks. We really can. On the worship issue, look, if for the divine service you keep confession absolution, it's the gospel after all, isn't it? If you keep confession absolution, if you don't ditch the lessons, if you don't ditch the creed, if you're not monkeying with the words of institution, within that parameter, there is virtually unlimited freedom. There really is. Now, of course, everything is to be done in subjection to the Word of God. Sometimes we'll get it more or less right. But within that area, we can and should support one another. Now, if you got a praise service and you got a couple of bald boomers with ponytails playing guitar, I will jam with them that afternoon, but I'll probably go to the hymnal service. But I'm not going to condemn you for having that service. In fact, I'll support your ability and freedom to do so. We can do this. It's not that difficult. And we need to stop beating each other up. The mission is too important. Another prickly issue which will come before the Synod's Convention is the licensed lay deacon issue. We have about 600 consecrated, wonderful lay people, men and women, serving as licensed lay deacons across the Synod, educated as such. In 1989, the Wichita Convention said that it was okay to license men to do word and sacrament ministry in certain necessary cases. The challenge with that is that the Augsburg Confession says, no one should preach or teach unless he be rightly called. Now the Synod, the CTCR, and the Synod, according to the Book of Concord, has defined a right call, and that means examination. Is he apt to teach? Is he called? Does a congregation extend a call? And third, is he ordained? Is he placed in the ministry as a pastor, as he functions as such? This has caused a lot of controversy among us and disagreement for 30 years. I asked Larry Vogel to come up with a plan, to work with a task force, to try to come up with a plan to alleviate this situation in a way that gives us the flexibility to cover those small congregation, those urban needs, etc., with flexibility. And at the same time, make sure we're faithful to our biblical and confessional stance. He is coming out with a plan. I think he's just sent it to me. I haven't a chance to read it yet. But he and the others, Larry is a staff member of the CTCR. He and the others have come to the Council of Presidents on three or more occasions to talk it over. He has visited every district that makes heavy use and some that make no use of licensed lay deacons. What they are proposing is a colloquy into the SMP, specific ministry pastor. Now, these will be local colloquy committees. They may suggest a course at the licensed lay deacon training school or two. Look, the licensed lay deacons already have to do continuing education in most all cases. May suggest a visit to the seminary for a short-term period or something. Not only that, we in the Synod are prepared to set aside just under $500,000 to give so that finances are not an impediment for these situations. And we can make this happen and benefit the seminaries at the same time and make those guys who are actually carrying out the office of the ministry pastors. At the same time, those who are not consecrating the elements and not regularly preaching or administering the sacraments, we need more of you people. We need more lay people in these diaconic and deacon functions serving. The Atlantic District does exactly this. The Florida, Georgia, pretty much the same thing. And we want to support the licensed lay deacon or the lay deacon schools to get more people there, not to make fewer people. Educate fewer people to serve. Now, the left is going to shoot at this because it restricts freedom. The right's going to shoot at it because there's not enough education and these guys aren't, you know, really educated to be pastors. Well, I figure then it's just about right. Again, thank you very much. Thank you. I got one person. Our universities are in the best shape they've been in a long time, I'm convinced. Not only financially. Now I took some hits for raising the issue of Lutheran identity at our universities. And we appointed a task force mandated by the last convention, including university presidents, Pat Ferry, one of them, and others to talk about how we can assure that our universities remain closely connected to the church. And, you know, there have been some prickly issues we haven't quite solved yet. One issue is the universities need to have very qualified lay people and pastors serve on their boards who have a history of knowledge and support of the Concordias. And sometimes in the past that hasn't always been accomplished by elections at a national or district event. By the same token, the Synod, National Synod, has to have the accountability to know that its institutions are remaining faithful. I was in Chicago during the interim, and I met with a theological faculty there, and they were verily in tears, saying, look, we're teaching the Synod's positions on science, evolution, etc. here, and other issues, and it's being undone in other places in the school by rostered teachers sometimes. They were verily weeping, saying only 20% of the faculty were LCMS. You can't maintain a Lutheran institution with only 20% of the faculty being LCMS. So we brought this task force together a year and a half ago or more, and the first discussion kind of went like this. You can't measure Lutheran identity. How can you possibly measure that? And I said, look, you guys measure everything. You measure tuition, you measure the incoming students, you measure grades, you measure budgets, you measure grass seed, if there's any experts at measuring in the whole Synod, it's you. And I said, even if you took the controversial issues off the table, like take worship off the table, I bet we could agree on 90% of what it means to be Lutheran in higher education. Thank God, that group went to work and they came up with 10 points, including a minimum for Lutheran LCMS people on the faculty, the major positions in the university that have to be LCMS, et cetera, the leadership, and a number of other points, and they did it. And at a last meeting of LECNA, that's a group that is now folded because the ELCA has pulled out of it, but it was a meeting of Lutheran university leaders, Krieger from Irvine stood up and just read the 10 points and bore witness to the soul-saving grace of Jesus Christ. Do you know how rare that is? I mean, in this world, fantastic. Praise the Lord. So, we've got a number of things going. How much time do I have, David? About it? Zero? In conclusion, this may take a while. I'll see you tomorrow.